Hello everyone, and welcome back. My name is Mr. Hall, and today we are going to look at text features in nonfiction. Before I talk about text features, do you know what nonfiction is? It's okay if you don't. Nonfiction means that it is true. It's based in facts. It's not a story. It's text that is based in facts. Today, we are going to look at text features in nonfiction, and we are going to read a story or a book about elephants. There are many different text features that I would like to talk about. The first one is on the cover of the book. It is actually called the title. The title tells us what the entire book is going to be about. In this case, our book is going to be about elephants. There's another text feature that's located on the cover of the book, and it's also shown in a lot of different places throughout the book, and that is called real looking pictures or photographs. Can you see the photographs on the cover of the book? You can see that those photographs were taken with the camera, and it is an actual picture of elephants. The next thing that I would like to discuss with you is the table of contents. Many nonfiction books have what's called a table of contents in them. The table of contents tells you exactly what is in each part of the book. Additionally, it tells you the pages that it is located on. Can you see the table of contents that's displayed in the picture? In chapter 1, which starts off on page 6, it talks about thundering across the plains. Moving on to chapter 2, which is on page 10, we see that the title of that chapter is called Striving to Survive. And then there are several other chapters, but the last one that I'll talk about is chapter 3, which is on page 21, and it talks about life in the herd. So we can go to each one of those pages to see what that particular chapter is going to be about. Let's start off with chapter 1, Thundering Across the Plains. We know that that particular chapter starts on page 6. At the very top in big bold letters is the title of the chapter. And then underneath, you can see the text. I'll read a little bit of the text. It says, "A light breeze blows through the grasses of an African savanna. Suddenly, the silence is broken by loud, distant trumpeting. The ground shakes and trees sway. The noises grow louder as a herd of elephants thunder toward a nearby watering hole for a drink and a bath. Elephants are best known for their enormous size. In fact, the African elephant is the largest land animal on earth. African elephants reach heights of about 8 to 10 feet on average. They are also incredibly heavy. The largest elephant on record weighed about 24,000 pounds. This is more than 100 times the weight of an average adult man." Did you notice that in our reading, there were several facts that were listed? Additionally, there were some words that were in bold letters that are in red. Do you know what those words are? It's okay if you don't. Those are words that are called vocabulary words, or words that the reader may not know what they mean. The cool thing about nonfiction, though, is nonfiction allows us to determine what these words mean by looking at the glossary. The glossary, which I'll show you now, is found in the back of the book. So we'll turn to the back of the book, and in our section, it's called Words to Know. And let's look up the word savanna, because I'm not quite sure what a savanna is. So in the glossary, as you can see, all of the words are alphabetized in order, meaning in ABC order. All the A words go first, all the Z words go last. And let's look up the word savanna. I think it's right here. It says a savanna, and it even tells us how to pronounce it. A flat, grassy plain with few or no trees. So it's a grassy area with little to no trees that are there. And we know that this is where African elephants are. The other word on here that's in red that we did not know, or that I don't know, is the word heard. So going back to the glossary, let's figure out what the word heard means. It says herd, a group of animals that stays together or moves together. So it's kind of like a group of animals that stay together and move together. Kind of like a family in a sense, right? That was another text feature, the glossary, as well as the vocabulary words. Something else that's really, really important on this page is the picture that's located at the bottom of the text. The picture is really important because it comes with a caption. A caption tells us more specifically what the picture is going to be about. In addition to that, there's also labels. Labels on pictures tell us what is there. So in this picture, you see that there's a man next to the elephant, or behind the elephant rather, and it says adult male, 6 feet. So that's labeling what that is in the picture. On the other side, it says adult elephant, 10 and a half feet. Again, that is another label that tells us what is in that picture. And I think what the writer was trying to do in this picture is compare the size of a male to the size of an adult elephant. The last thing that I want to point your attention to is the very bottom. That is the caption in the picture. It says, elephant herds are a common sight in many parts of the African savanna. So that simply means that on the African savanna, you'll see many different elephant herds. Those were some of the text features that were listed on the first page in chapter 1. As we progress through, we see another picture, and this is a photograph of an elephant. The next thing that I want to talk about is a heading. Headings are typically found at the top of the page, and headings will tell us what the particular text that we are reading is going to be about, that particular section. So I'll read this heading to you. It's called Not Quite the Same. Let's read a little bit about what not quite the same means for the reader. There are 3 different species of elephants. The African savanna elephant and the African forest elephant are found in different parts of Africa. These 2 species are very closely related. Until the early 2000s, most scientists organized them together as a single species. Forest elephants are slightly smaller than their savanna relatives and have slimmer tusks. They also live in different environments. Forest elephants are found mainly in wooded rainforest areas, while savanna elephants roam Africa's grasslands. Hopefully, from this particular section, you were able to see that there are 2 different kinds of elephants, and that up until like the 2000s, many of the elephants were categorized together, but now they're categorized separately. Additionally, here you can see that there are some words that are in red and are in bold. Those are words that, again, that the writer doesn't think the reader knows. So they clarify them by putting them in the glossary and defining what they mean. The next thing that I would like to talk about is a map. Hopefully you can see from the picture that this is a habitat map. So it shows you where the most elephants are found across the world. As you can see, elephants don't really inhabit North America or South America, according to this map. We find elephants in Central and Southern Africa, as well as over in the southern parts of Asia. Elephants are really found there. So a map is also a text feature. Another really important text feature is called the index. The index is located in the back of the book and is typically the very last page in a nonfiction book. The index tells us what topics are explored in the book. So if we look at this index, we know that if I wanted to learn about captivity or elephants being held, that we can look on pages 34 and 35 to find that. Additionally, if we wanted to learn more about elephants' eyesight, we can go to page 13 to find out more about that. And then the very last thing in this nonfiction book is what's called a resource page. And resource pages allow you to explore more about the topic, because we know that one nonfiction book isn't going to tell us everything about elephants. So it gives us another list of books that we can use to further our research about elephants. Today, we looked at nonfiction text features. I encourage you to continue to read nonfiction and locate the text features that are there. Nonfiction text features help the reader better understand the story, and you are able to navigate through the story a little bit more quickly because you know what features are in the text. Thank you so much for joining me today, and I hope to see you again soon.
Hello, my name is Mrs. Overish, and this is Math Mania for first and second graders. I'm so happy you're here today. Let's learn something new in math. Today, we're going to be talking about subtracting three-digit numbers using a place value chart. All you need is a piece of paper, maybe two, and a pencil or a pen or a marker or a crayon, whatever you have to write with at home. Okay, let's get started. First, we have our I can statement. Our I can statement today says, I can subtract three-digit numbers using a place value chart. So we're gonna be doing exactly that. We're gonna be subtracting or taking away we have subtract or take away a three-digit number, so a number that has three digits, and using a place value chart. So using that place value chart really shows us the value of each digit in a number. So we'll be able to break apart the number before we subtract. So using a place value chart, so a chart that shows the digits' values. All right, let's go ahead and get started. Our first example today says 435 minus 214. So last week and the week before that, we were practicing using a place value chart, but with addition. And when we did addition, we put both numbers in our place value chart and then counted everything up, and that's how we found our answer. It's gonna be a little different with subtraction. And some might say even just a little bit easier. So with subtraction, we are only gonna put that top number or the bigger number in our place value chart. So which number are we gonna put in our place value chart? That's right, we're gonna put that number 435. And does anyone remember from the past couple weeks where we should start? You think we should start in the hundreds, tens, or the ones place? So let's start in the ones place. So I see a five. So I'm gonna draw five ones in the ones place. Four, five. All right, then we move to our tens place. And how many do we have in the tens place? A three, so I'm gonna put three tens. One, two, three. Then moving right along, we move to our hundreds place. And we have four hundreds. So we have one, two, three, four. All right, now this is where it gets different from the addition. Instead of putting the number 214 in our chart, we don't need to do that because we're subtracting or taking away. So we wanna take away this number from this number. So we're taking away 214 from 435. If we break it down by each individual place value, we're taking away four from five. So I come over here to my five or to my ones place, and I'm gonna take away four. So I'm just gonna cross out four of them. One, two, three, four. And I see that I have one left. Let's move to the tens column. I'm gonna take away one because there's a one in my tens column in the number 214. Cross one out, I have one, two left. So I put a two in my tens column. Then I move to my hundreds place where there's a two in the hundreds place in the number 214. So I take away two of them. And now I have one, two left.
And down here, we have our answer, or what we have left in all of our place values, and the answer is 221. Pretty easy, right? Let's try one together. Go ahead and get a piece of paper and a pencil, and we'll do the next one all together. Okay, so now that you have your piece of paper and pencil, our problem is 686 minus 346. So go ahead and get this in the corner of your paper. You want your paper to look kind of similar to this big chart I have. And then when drawing your hundreds, tens, and ones charts, the best way to do it is to draw our long line first across our paper, because we don't want to make it too small that then we can't fit or draw all the pieces we need to put into it. So if we draw our line big, long across the rest of our paper, then we can come down and draw one line down, leave a bunch of space, and draw another line down. And that's it. All you have to do is three lines. Then we put our H for hundreds, our T for tens, and our O for ones. All right, let's do the problem together. So we first have our number 686 minus 346. Which number are we gonna put in the chart today? That's right, our bigger one, or our top number, 686. Starting our ones column, there's a six. So let's put six ones in the ones column. 3, 4, 5, 6. Then we're gonna move right into our tens column. I come back to my number and I see that we have 8. So I'm gonna draw 8 ten rods. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then moving right along, we move into our hundreds place. And I see we have a 6 again. So I'm gonna draw 6 hundreds. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Those are definitely all different sizes, but it doesn't have to be perfect. I just know that this represents the number 6. Okay, now for our next step, who remembers what we're gonna do? Well, we're gonna take away, or we're gonna subtract, and we're gonna go place by place, value by value, all right? So I start with my ones place, and I see I'm taking away 6 from 6. So let's cross out 6 ones. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. How many do we have left? Nothing. So we know that there's going to be a 0 in that ones place. Let's move to our tens column. I come back to my problem. I see that I have a 4. So I'm going to take away 4 tens. 1, 2, 3, 4. How many do we have left? 1, 2, 3, 4. So I know there's gonna be a 4 in my tens column. And then last but not least, we have our hundreds column. Come back to our problem. I see there's a 3, cross out 3. And I have 1, 2, 3 left. So what's my answer? Can anyone read this number? 340. Okay, go ahead and flip your paper over. Let's do one more. Okay, on your paper, write 819 minus 504. And which number are we gonna put in our place value chart? That's right, 819. So I'm going to take my marker and I'm gonna start with my ones place, and I'm gonna draw 9 ones.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
And should I move to my hundreds place or to my tens place? Let's move right next to our tens place where I have just one 10. So I draw one 10. And then our hundreds are last, and I have 8 hundreds. So I'm gonna draw 8 hundreds.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
And now instead of adding the number 504 to our place value chart, I notice the subtraction sign, so I know we're gonna be taking it away. So I'm going to cross out what we need to in each place value. So I start again in my ones place, and I see there's a 4 in my ones place, so I'm gonna cross out four ones. One, two, three, four. And how many ones do we have left over? That's right, we have five. I move to my tens column and I see a zero. So should I cross anything out? No way. We're just gonna keep that one right there and I know that we're gonna have one 10. All right, move to our hundreds column and I see a five. So I know I'm gonna take away five hundreds. One, two, three, four, five. How many do we have left? Three. So what's our answer to 819 minus 504? All right, 315. Okay, now of course I have a challenge for you today, and this challenge is a word problem. I want you to see if you can listen to the problem and pick out the numbers that you're gonna need to subtract for me today. Are you ready? Okay, here we go. So, Rosie and I went to the park. It's one of our favorite activities. We like to go and sit by the lake. So we went to the park and we counted 485 ducks in the pond. It was crazy. Rosie was so excited, barked at all of them. Then 213 of the ducks flew away. They said peace. Rosie was barking at them. They didn't want to be there anymore. So how many ducks were left in the pond? 485 were in the pond there originally. Then 213 of them flew away. So how many are left? Well, first we got to set our problem up. So I want you to see if you can set the problem up. What was that first really big number? 485. And then how many ducks flew away? 213. So I know I need to take away 213 to find out how many ducks are left. Can you draw your place value chart and put our number 485 in the hundreds, tens, and ones place? And then take away the hundreds, tens, and ones from the number 213. You'll get your answer if you do it that way. All right, you guys did a wonderful job today practicing three-digit subtraction. Thank you so much for coming. This was Math Mania. And my name is Mrs. Overish. I'll see you next time.
Hello and welcome back to first and second grade science with me, Miss Allen. We have been learning all about the Earth. We learned about the impact that air, water, and wind have on the Earth. We learned about the impact that natural hazards have on the Earth. And now we are going to learn about the impact that we, as humans, have on Earth and Earth's environment. An environment are the surroundings or conditions that a plant, animal, or person lives. It's a system of living and non-living things functioning together. Today we are going to talk about Earth's environment and how do humans impact Earth's environment. Humans have a huge impact on Earth's environment from the way that we live our lives. The choices we make each day impact how healthy our Earth's environment is. Making positive daily choices makes sure that the land, air, and water that help us to survive stays clean in full abundance, so lots of it. However, we can also make harmful daily choices that cause the land, air, and water of Earth's environment to become polluted and unable to be used. Some of those negative impacts might cause extreme erosion, too much trash, poor air quality, or undrinkable water. I'm going to show you some pictures of some negative or harmful choices in keeping Earth's environment healthy, and I want you to think about a way we can change that choice and make it a positive choice. What can we do to make things better? In this picture, you can see a picnic spot at a park. What do you notice about the picture? I see trash on top of the picnic table and underneath the picnic table in the trash. Trash in a park can cause harm to different living things that live there. Animals could eat the trash and it might make them sick. And strong weather with wind and rain can make the trash go into rivers, ponds, and other natural areas in the park. How can we make this better? What could you do to change this situation? Next picture. This shows someone who took care of the park and the picnic spot. They made sure that it was nice and clean when they left. This picture shows a car trunk after a family went to the store. The groceries have been put into plastic bags. Sometimes we use plastic bags out of convenience. However, the plastic cannot be recycled. It's harmful to the earth to use too much plastic. What could you do instead? We could use reusable bags so that we can take them to the store and use them more than one time. This next picture shows the side of a road. You can see trash on the side of the road. Why might there be trash on the side of the road? Maybe people driving in their cars throw trash out of their windows. That's called littering. What could you do with your trash instead of littering or throwing it out of your window while you're in the car? You could be patient and wait until you pull over or get home to a place that has a trash can or a recycling bin. That is taking care of our earth and making it a more beautiful place. This photo shows a garden bed. The garden bed has plants that haven't been taken care of. How could you make this better? You could plant new seeds and take care of the plants and the seeds and help them grow into vegetables and different plants. This cleans the air around the garden and makes the earth more beautiful. At this beach, we can see plastic single-use water bottles. They've been left here and maybe washed up by the water. What could we do to make sure this doesn't happen? What could you change? Maybe you already do this and you use a reusable water bottle, a water bottle that you can use more than one time. We're going to talk about three quick tips on making positive choices and positive habits that make our Earth's environment healthy. Those three tips are reducing, reusing, and recycling. Reducing means using less of a vital resource for Earth's environment. For example, using less water. What's a way you can use less water in your daily habits? I'm thinking, when I brush my teeth, I could turn the water off while I scrub my teeth clean and then turn it back on to rinse out. Think of a way you could use either maybe less paper or less water. Think of a way we can use less of some vital resources. That is reducing. The next one is reusing. How can you reuse something more than one time? Reusing things helps us eliminate waste. You could bring a bag to the store. I could bring this bag to the store every time I shop. It will not be thrown away. I can reuse it. This saves me from using the plastic bags at the grocery store that might just get thrown away. My challenge to you is to work with your family members or friends to come up with three ways you can make a healthy, positive impact on Earth's environment. Maybe there's a small change you can make in your daily habits that will make a big change to Earth's environment. Thanks for joining me this week as we talked about humans' impact on Earth's environment and how we can be positive change makers. See you next time.
Welcome to our Chinese class. 欢迎学汉语. This is Miss Yang, and this is the Chinese lesson for grade 1 and grade 2 student. Today, we are going to go over how to say pet in Chinese. What you will need today is a notebook and a pencil if you need to take a note. Okay, let's get ready to learn. Our can-do statement for today. I can identify some common pet. I can ask someone whether they have a dog, cat, or pet. I can tell how many dogs, cat, pet I have. Great! Now, 请听我说。请听我说。 你有狗吗? 你有狗吗? 它很可爱。它很可爱。 Do you have a dog? 你有狗吗? 它很可爱。 它很可爱, it's very cute. 这是什么? 这是什么? 狗, 狗。 这是什么? 这是什么? 也是狗, 狗。 这是什么? 这是什么? 这是猫, 这是猫。 这是什么? 这是什么? 这也是猫, 这也是猫。 宠物, 宠物, 猫, 猫, 狗, 狗, 鱼, 鱼, 鸟, 鸟, 宠物, 宠物, 非常好, great. Now, 你有狗吗? 你有狗吗? 我有, 我有, 我没有, 我没有。 你有狗吗? 我有, 我没有。 你有猫吗? 你有猫吗? 我有, 我有, 我没有, 我没有。 Great! Now, 请跟我说, 请跟我说, please say with me. 这是什么? 这是什么? 狗, 狗, great. 这是什么? 这是什么? 狗, great. 这是什么? 猫, 猫, 这是什么？猫，猫，宠物，宠物，宠物狗，宠物猫，宠物鱼，宠物鸟。Great, 再来一遍。宠物，宠物猫，宠物狗，宠物鱼，宠物鸟。Great, 你有狗吗？你有狗吗？ I have, 我有，我有。 I don't have, 我没有，我没有。你有猫吗？你有猫吗？我有，我没有。非常好， great. Let's see more pictures. 你有宠物吗？你有宠物吗？我有，我没有。Now let's do an activity. Do you have a dog, cat, any pet? Work with your parent. Find out if your parent has any pet. First, ask if your parent has a dog, then a cat, then any pet. Let's try to use those sentences to ask. 你有猫吗？你有狗吗？你有宠物吗？ We can answer 有，没有，有，没有。 Great. So we can ask 你有猫吗？你有狗吗？你有宠物吗？有，没有。 Great. Now, let's learn a new measure word for animal. We use 只，只。When we say a cat, we say 一只猫，一只猫。When we say a dog, we say一只狗，一只狗。 Great. So we use 只 for animal. 几只狗，几只狗。 Let's count. 一， we can say 一只狗，一只狗。几只狗，几只狗。 Let's count. 一，二，二。 We say, when we say with measure word, we say 两。 So instead of saying 二只狗, we say 两只狗。 两只狗。 Two dogs.几只狗，几只狗。我们数一数，一、二、三，三只狗，三只狗。Great. 几只狗，几只狗。Let's count. 一、二、三、四，四只狗。四只狗，非常好。几只猫，几只猫。 数一数。一，一只猫，一只猫。几只猫？几只猫？ Let's count together. 一、二。We don't say 二只猫， we say 两。We can say 两只猫，两只猫。Great. 几只猫？数一数，一、二。三，三只猫，三只猫。 Great. 几只猫？数一数，一、二、三、四，四只猫，四只猫。一只狗。 Excellent. 它有猫吗？没有。他有狗吗？有。他有几只狗？一、二。他有两只狗，两只狗。 Two dogs. Great. Now, let's see our assignment for this week.Practice asking someone whether they have a dog, cat, or pet in Chinese. If your neighbor has a pet, ask him or her how many cats, dog, or other pet he or she has. We can use question and answer in Chinese. 你有猫吗？你有狗吗？ I have. 我有。I don't have. 我没有。When we asking how many, we can say 你有几只猫？你有几只狗？ We can answer 我有一只，两只，三只猫，狗。Great. That concludes our lesson for today.It has been my pleasure to have you in this class. See you next week. 再见，再见。
HOTEP scholars, I'm Professor Horton, and once again, this is STEM for second grade. We've been talking all about matter. We said that matter has three states: solid,liquid, and gas. We said that solid is matter that has both size and shape. We said that liquid is matter that has size but no shape. And gas is matter that has neither size or shape. For today's activity, we are going to document the transformation of matter from a solid to a liquid, and then back into a solid again. In today's lab experiment, we're actually going to create crystal candy. Crystal candy basically starts out as a solid when it is in the sugar state, and then it turns into a liquid when it is mixed into the water and boiled.And then it goes back into a solid state when it's transformed into crystal candy. So join me in today's lab when we create our own crystal candy.
Okay, scholars, for this experiment, you will need brown sugar, a measuring cup, a stick,to put your crystallized candy on, and you will need to boil your water and mix in the sugar. So you will have to use
2 cups of water and 6 cups of sugar. Now you can either use regular sugar or brown sugar. I chose brown sugar, which is why my water is brown. But before you get started, make sure that you get your parents' permission and you have their assistance to boil the water and mix in the sugar. Once again, that's 2 cups of water and 6 cups of sugar. Once again, there is the measuring cup. And here's the stick that I'll use for my crystallized candy. And there's the brown sugar. The first thing that you need to do is we're going to take the stick and we have to wet it. So we're going to go ahead and place it in the water. Let it sit there for a couple of seconds. I'm going to go ahead and open up the brown sugar. The stick needs to be wet so that the brown sugar will stick onto the stick. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to roll the stick in the brown sugar to make sure that some of the sugar is sticking onto the stick. Now the reason for this is because we need what is called seed crystals. And so this is basically going to allow, as the sugar crystallizes, it will stick to the places on the stick where there are seed crystals. So this step is very important, but you also have to make sure that you allow this to dry before you put it back into the cup. So at this point, it's still wet, and I'm actually going to put this one to the side, and I have one that's already dry that I can go ahead and place into the sugar water. So this experiment actually takes 7 days. Here's the dry one. You can see the seed crystals that are already on it. I'm just going to place it into the sugar water, and you're actually going to have to leave it there for 7 days.
All right, scholars. So, as usual, get your parents' permission. Make sure that they also assist you, because once again, you are going to need to mix in 2 cups of water, boiling water, with 6 cups of sugar. It could either be brown sugar or it could be regular sugar. If you use regular sugar, it's also a good idea to use, or a fun idea to use, food coloring. But once again, that's up to you. But you do need your parents' permission. Try this experiment at home and document each step in your launch log. All right, scholars, that's all I have for you. Have a great day.
Kindergarten is great at Kansas City Public Schools.
I know this. They have really good teachers. I know this is a great school.
They teach them stuff that I thought my kids would never be able to know at the age of five.
Since deciding to send our kiddos to a neighborhood school, we've become even more of a part of our community.
Now is the time to enroll your future kindergartner for the new school year. Visit enrollkc.org today.
Academy, Kansas City one and only immersion school for Chinese and Spanish.
We are so happy to have you visit FLA. I'm Dr. Joel Ramsdell, the principal of Foreign Language Academy. We are the region's only international baccalaureate school that is authorized as a primary years program, as well as being in candidacy for our middle years program. We look forward to sharing more about our school with you.
Bienvenidos al cuarto grado.
Immersion is the best way for a student to become fluent in a foreign language.
At FLA, we have a strong sense of community. Our parent-teacher organization meets monthly and organizes different events and activities such as Arts Night, where students can showcase their artwork and also enjoy live performances by students.
Each year, the 8th grade Spanish student fundraises to help support a trip to Costa Rica.
Children at FLA have an advantage, learning English as well as a foreign language. This will prepare them for not only being in the classroom, but beyond.
When our families join FLA, they select a school for their kids that is elementary and middle school. Our students are able to experience the full immersion program since kindergarten all the way to 8th grade.
Thank you for joining us on this virtual tour. We appreciate it. If you would like to learn more about the Foreign Language Academy or schedule a personal tour, please call our school phone number, which is 816-418-6000. We look forward to sharing all of the great things that we're doing here at the Foreign Language Academy with you.
Hello, we're happy to have you visit Carver. We are a dual language school where our students become truly bilingual and biliterate.
Welcome to Carver Dual Language.
Thank you.
grado en Carver.
Welcome to first grade in Carver. In kindergarten and first grade, all students learn to read and write in Spanish.
Welcome to fourth grade at Carver. In fourth grade, our students have the opportunity to join our robotics team. Our students work together on a community project and learn to code a robot's movement.
By sixth grade, Carver students are truly bilingual and biliterate.
Students can fluently speak, read, and write in both Spanish and English. Carver students move on to much success in middle school, high school, and beyond.
We celebrate Hispanic heritage throughout the year at Carver Dual Language. Each year, students develop a plan to make goods to develop and to sell at our mercado. This is our annual fall market that classes have booths that students come together and sell their items that they've created. Staff, community members, family, parents, grandparents, all can come together, buy the goods, and celebrate Hispanic heritage together.
In Carver, we have an involved PTA where parents and families can be part of our school community.
Thank you for joining us on this tour. If you would like to schedule a personal tour or learn more about our school, please call 816-418-4925.